Hey, if you're trying to design your own smoker and you want to know how efficient should this smoker be, watch this video. So my name is Frank Cox, and for the last 30 years, I've been in the mechanical trades. I owned a refrigeration, food equipment, and HVAC company, and did repair and installation for a lot of different applications. We moved a lot of air and a lot of temperature, but not only that, I own a company called SmokerBuilder, and that's been around for about 14 years. Altogether, I've been a barbecue and pitmaster enthusiast for about 17 of those years. And I've used my background in the refrigeration and mechanical trades, along with my experience of smoker design and smoker fabrication and being a pitmaster, to come to this understanding of what I think I know now in regards to how the most efficient design is for a smoker. So what I did is I wrote down a whole bunch of notes because I can't say all of this on video. I can have a conversation with you about it. So I'm going to be looking at my notes once in a while here. But I want to give you a guide in this video and this podcast episode that's going to help you decide how efficient your smoker really needs to be. And the gist of this is that anytime you bring up efficiency in a conversation as far as design of anything, we have to also take into consideration the compromises that are made with how it runs, the end product, how it's going to affect the net result. Now, something that I've noticed over the years, and first of all, I want to tell you that when I started smokerplans.net, I was a super fan of a kind of smoker called a reverse flow smoker, and all of our design took into consideration how much blood can we squeeze from the proverbial stone here, right? Like how much efficiency can we squeeze out of this smoker? How efficient can I get the temperatures left to right? How often, how much can I decrease the amount of time needed to tend this fire and things like that? And we stuck to those designs. Matter of fact, we still use them in certain situations. We stuck to those designs for our plans for over a decade. Until finally one day I was like, you know what? There's a lot of complaints about pellet smokers and different kinds of smokers that are set it and forget it. They squeeze the maximum efficiency out of the least amount of wood and the most convenience for the pitmaster where they can turn a dial on and walk away from it. And, you know, the biggest complaint for those from those people was a lack of smoke flavor. And so I started to wonder, like, maybe I'm doing something wrong because I am burning wood. And I'm not getting the depth of flavor that some of my buddies are getting with their inefficient smoker. So then I made some observations. And, you know, there's some mammoth pit builders out there, you know, really great guys, phenomenal designs. And there's some phenomenal pit masters cooking on their pits. And, you know, I noticed a lot of those designs went against what I always was saying with reverse flows and things like that. The biggest one being firebox size, and some of them were insulated, and we said you should insulate at the time, and a lot of guys said you shouldn't insulate, and, you know, a lot of different things like that. The observation I made after I realized there was an issue with smoke flavor and the design of my pits, the observation I made was, first of all, these guys are doing what I say would be wrong. I would never build a pit that way. And their pit masters are all doing a really great job. So therefore, there must be a problem with what I'm saying. So I started playing around with making a dirtier fire. Now, when I say dirty fire, I mean sloppier compared to what I would normally have if I was doing a reverse flow. For instance, log rack up off the bottom, really good coal bed, clear smoke coming out of the smokestack. And see, the problem with that is that it's too clean, and that's why I was losing smoke flavor. You have some. I'm not saying there's none whatsoever, but it's not that what I was looking for in the flavor of my food. I actually had people, customers that built pits that complained about it a little bit. So anyway, what I did is I started to like deviate from my original design, and I consulted with a few pit masters that were running pits like that. And even had questions for a few of my buddies that are professional builders and asked them, like, well, how do you fix this, you know, and listen to what they had to say. So a big part of it is, I believe, when I say sloppier fire, we're talking about, like, we want to have blue smoke. We don't want clear smoke. We want like blue smoke coming out of the smokestack. Another thing is that when you have a lot of like a big coal bed, you usually don't have big flames. If you ever think about a charcoal grill, it never really flares up until something else hits the coal bed. Like in a charcoal grill or something like that, you may see very tiny, very small flames, or you may not see any at all, but you've got mega amounts of heat coming off of that coal bed. So what happens is that we need to have a flame in order to have wood in the smoker so that we get complete combustion, but still have a sloppy fire. So we're going to need to have some, you know, lazy flames in there, let's call it. You want to have not very small, but not very big flames either. We need to be able to control it so that we can control our temperature, right? So I started playing around with that a little bit. I went really dirty, and then I went really clean, and then I kind of tried to find some kind of a happy medium in there. I looked at thicker blue smoke as compared to thinner blue smoke. It just took a lot of time of running pits, a lot of cook sessions, a lot of opinions from other people, a lot of observation from what the community was doing, especially the professional pit masters with restaurants and stuff like that. So one day I kind of stumbled upon an idea from my friend Cosmo, and this is not new technology, you know, it's just like the obvious is sitting right in front of us. And, you know, I just sat down with him. We just had some beers at a conference we were at together, and, you know, he kind of drew up some sketches on a napkin there with me of this vertical baffle that he was playing around with. And I was like, okay, well, I explained it to me because I'm not getting it. Like, we're not getting air where our food is. All the air is going up to the top. And he said, imagine it like an upside down bucket, right? You fill a bucket with water, what's going to happen? It's going to fill all the way to the top with water, and then it's going to overflow. If you flip the bucket upside down and pretend it's hot air, now we're putting hot air in, and it all goes to the top, and it starts to fill its way down, right? Bing, the light bulb came on. I was like, okay. So it's not that we're just like not getting air around the food. We're letting it go up to the top and calm down that super intense heat, letting it calm down. And then we're letting that air turbulate and come back down like the weather does. Warm air goes up, cool air goes down, and that air exchanges like that. And that's what causes spin in the weather, right? That's all we're doing in our pit design. So for those of you that don't know what I'm talking about, you can go over to Mad Scientist BBQ's YouTube channel and also his Patreon. And you can look at a whole bunch of videos about a pit that I'm building right now for him that's called the Solution Offset Smoker. And I'd invite you to follow along on his channel and look at that stuff. I'm not here to sell that pit right now. I'm here to tell you, you know, what works and what doesn't work. So anyway, on my notes here, what I did is I made this awesome list. I'm going to publish for you in better language here. But it's basically smoker efficiency and the compromises that we have to make in order to have an efficient pit. You know, so the one thing up here, I'm going to be looking down at this periodically for those guys watching the video, but there's like four things that people are trying to squeeze out of a pit when they start talking about efficiency. And these usually are the result of what they would perceive as complaints or problems with a smoker they've either ran in the past or their fear going into buying or building a smoker, right? So the first efficiency that they're trying to get is burn less wood. Now, we are on the phone constantly with builders of pits and also with buyers of pits from all walks of life, all different countries around the world. And this is something that we hear all the time in our conversations is, I want to burn less wood. Reasons they want to do it is a couple of different things. The second thing is they on here is one of them. Burn longer. So in other words, what they want to do is go out and feed the fire, and then they want to go back inside and not think about it for 2 hours, 2.5 hours. And, you know, in a stick burner, that's just not optimal. You're going to get suboptimal results if you do that, mostly because of the way that the fire has to be burned, the size of the fire, which we'll get into here in a minute. But the other reason that someone will want to burn less wood back on the first bullet point there is because they may not have accessibility to wood. For instance, if you're one of those guys that lives up in Alaska, you're not gonna have like hickory and cherry and apple and, you know, different species of oak and stuff. It's gonna be pretty hard to find. There are woods there that you can burn, but you're not going to be able to get like post oak, probably, that I know of. Maybe you can. Other areas of the country can't get a hold of hickory and cherry and stuff like that. They got a lot of pine and evergreens and cedars, stuff like that. So wood consumption is a concern, you know, why you would want your smoker to be more efficient. Not saying it's wrong to be more efficient. We're just talking about like the kind of product that I want to cook and how I want my food to be. And if you're like me, this will make sense to you. So another thing that pitmasters don't want to sacrifice, though, by getting these longer burns and getting this increased efficiency, they kind of loop in something that's unrelated, which is even temperatures, which I'll explain that, why that is not, it's like a conflict is what that's called in physics. We want, you know, to burn less wood, and we want to have our burn times last longer, but we also don't want to lose even temperatures. There's a relationship there, cause and effect-wise, where the compromise happens. The other one is we have to also think about, why are we doing this to begin with? Why would we change from a pellet smoker that's effortless to use to a stick burner to begin with? We're unhappy with our other result, right? So we want better results. So here we go with this one. The fourth reason that people seek efficiency out of their smoker is they want better product than they got before, and they also want more of it. So in other words, we want to increase the yield of our product. So sometimes when you squeak out efficiency of your fire and of your smoker, what you wind up with is a lot more BTUs, because now we're cooking with a coal bed. If that coal bed gets too hot, then you wind up with hot air. You wind up with a lot more heat in that air mass. And so that can actually burn, like on some of the smokers that just, like on some of the offset smokers where there's a firebox, you're burning your fire and you're moving as much air as you can to get even temps, you wind up blistering the briskets or whatever's on that firebox end of the pit. Most of you have probably faced that, especially with cheap offset smokers from like box stores and stuff. You get into that. So kind of here, we're going to go into those four items as they are, like, the what they are versus the compromise you gotta make. So the first one I'm gonna talk about here, and I'm looking down at my notes because I can't remember how I wrote this off on the top of my head. The first we're gonna talk about here is less wood versus those compromises, right? So when we're starting to burn, if we wanna burn less wood, we already talked about the whole reason for doing that is saving money, right? Or saving time, because you don't wanna go outside and constantly tend a fire, right? So how do we achieve this? Well, the one way we achieve it is to insulate the firebox. We're now talking about a bigger pit, something like 100 gallon, like a 24 by 48 or bigger. Smaller pits, you don't really have as much fuss with this, but if you do insulate a firebox on a smaller pit, you'll completely understand what I'm about to say if you have any time running an insulated fire. You wind up trying to burn less wood, right? And you have an insulated firebox, and so you're conserving more heat into that airstream that's going through your firebox, right? Makes sense? Okay, so then we have to cut back how much air volume in order to maintain temperature. If we let the fire have too much air, it's gonna consume the wood too quick. Also, if we let the fire have too much air, it's going to move too much heat into the into the cook chamber. So there we go. Now we have a conflict we have to deal with somehow. How do I maintain a longer burning fire and get enough air through my cooker to have even cook chamber temps and also not overshoot temp and have too intense of a heat hitting the end of my briskets on the cook chamber, on the first cooking grade of the cook chamber there? So what we're dealing with here is if we insulate that firebox and achieve more efficiency and burn a fire, we're gonna have to minimize the size of that fire, which is what we're looking to do, but we're gonna not have enough air volume to move enough flavor and to move enough, we're not gonna be able to have enough wood on the fire, not move enough air volume, which decreases the evenness of temps, because air is how we're heating in our cook chamber. And we're also going to lose flavor. trying to read these notes and say it. So I hope that made sense. If not, hit me in the comments. Let me know I'm a fool. But anyway, what I'm telling you is essentially that last statement there. So the second thing we're trying to get out of this, like I said, is we're wanting to burn longer in between tending the fire. Like when we go out to tend on the fire, add a log, stir the coal bed, take coals out, whatever we got to do to keep our cooker at temperature, open, shut the door. So burning longer, the only way you can really do that is to add more fuel. Well, if we add more fuel, then we got to cut way back on air, especially if you have an insulated firebox, which in our minds would just mean it's going to be more efficient, right? So if we was to go out and throw a bunch of wood in the firebox of a box store offset, then that fire eventually will complete, all that wood will turn into charcoal, and all of that charcoal eventually will become coal bed that has, it is on fire without flames. Like I said in the beginning of this, the flames aren't really there. We're just getting all that heat we're harvesting out of that because of a complete combustion. So therefore, we're going to have to like really tighten things down. We're going to have to shut down our air going into the firebox. Well, the air movement through the pit, just like in the bucket explanation, we're filling it up from the top. We want to completely fill it so that the air goes all the way down, right? In an offset smoker, especially. So if we're tightening down the air entering the firebox, we're not going to get enough air into the cook chamber to bring the heat and the flavor. Therefore, we wind up with uneven cook chamber temps, and we wind up with less flavor in our barbecue. And also what heat does come into the cook chamber is all hitting that first little bit of the cooking grate. And now we're also getting blistered food, which decreases yield on our briskets. In other words, we cooked four briskets and we walk out of there with the beginning third of a brisket burned, or two of them burned. Then we wind up with less of that brisket we were able to yield out of what we just cooked. Anyway, so there's that. We also have to have, if you decrease, this is another thing I didn't even write down. If you have that situation, you're going to wind up flipping, rotating your food constantly and spritzing and things like that, trying to keep stuff moist. So since we're not cooking evenly, there's more, now there's more labor put into running your fire in the, and managing your meat to keep your temperature down and also move your meat around so it cooks evenly. So here we got all kinds of problems that happened with that cause and effect there. So to kind of sum that part of it up, I'm going to read off my notes here. So less fuel equals more fire tending, right? Also equals more, burn longer between temps means less fuel, which means more tending, right? Because you got to add more fuel more often. Tighter air design, because you want to add more fuel, equals less air volume moving through the cook chamber temp, which moving through your cook chamber yields uneven temperatures. And then we also wind up with a cleaner fire because now there's less oxygen, less fuel in the cook chamber, more coal bed. And so now we don't get that thin blue smoke hitting our brisket and giving that awesome bark, that phenomenal smoke ring, and the texture and everything we're looking for, because that all comes from the smoke and the air movement around that brisket. So what are my solutions to this? So I want to burn personally a bigger fire, and I want more air, because what I'm trying to seek out is I'm designing backwards my end product backwards to how do I achieve it? That's just kind of how I attack smoker design. So I want my brisket to be juicy. I want my briskets, all of them. If I've got eight briskets in a big old pit, I want the first brisket and the last brisket to be the same. I want to minimize how many times I've got to open a door and lose my heat out of the chamber and spritz. And I don't want to do any of that. I want to be able to put my briskets on, fat cap up in this scenario, so all of that fat renders and it goes down, the tallow and everything stays on top of the brisket. I want that air just gently touching the top of these briskets and surrounding it. And I want to get that flavor in there. I want an even smoke ring all the way around that brisket. I want the bark on top to match the bark on the bottom. This is how I want my briskets to turn out, right? Or my ribs or pork butts or whatever I'm cooking in this big smoker. Well, the only way I'm going to be able to achieve that is with enough air, a big enough fire, enough smoke, and even temps. Okay, so here's what we have to take into consideration in order to hit that. And remember the bucket analogy as I go through this little list I'm going to try to read off that I suck at reading because I don't have my glasses on. So those of you that know me know that I have to wear glasses to read. So first thing we're going to have to take into consideration is the cook chamber volume and the length of the chamber. This is a big one here because in smoker design, you're going to, let's say, a 1,000-gallon pit. So the biggest smoker I've designed is a 3,300-gallon reverse flow. It works, believe it or not. The customer that built it, it was him and his wife, him and his daughter had their pipeliners, and they had a big stainless water tank, and they wanted to make this big elaborate cooker out of it. So in this situation, that thing was 20 feet long and 60 inches in diameter. So with that being said, those plans are on smokerplans.net if you want to see them. We have to have a phenomenal amount of air moving in that chamber. Second thing is we have to have enough air filling that chamber. So imagine we have to move 3,300 gallons of air through this pit while we're cooking on it, right? Because we're putting some in, we're taking some out. So if we're having a 20% air exchange or a 30% air exchange, that means if 30%, 1,000 gallons of air has to go through this pit in the given amount of time that we're designing for, 1 hour. So we can move 1,000 gallons of air through this pit in 1 hour. Okay, that's insane. And we're also trying to maintain the temperature of that air, and we're also trying to maintain the flavor from that. We want it to be even, which is the whole reason we built a reverse flow to begin with. So there we go. Now we got to take into consideration, that's why it matters on big pits and small pits, why the cook chamber volume and the firebox volume have to match in order to get this result that I'm talking about. So imagine it kind of like this, right? The firebox would be the motor in a car, and the car is what we're trying to move with the motor, okay? And I love this analogy. I had to do stuff like this for my techs when I taught, because I had to teach all my guys. Our guys were guitar players. That was the best refrigeration guys we could hire, you know. People that came out of school, it just felt like it took way more to teach those guys how to work on a supermarket rack system or a refrigerated case at somewhere or a commercial steamer. It took way more energy to teach that guy to work on that than it did to hire a guitar player. So we had to explain things very well, and we had to use a lot of metaphor, and that's what this is. So imagine you have this car, and the motor in the car is the firebox, and the car is the load or the work we're trying to do. We're trying to move that car, okay? So we could put a V4 in a semi truck, and it's not going to do much, right? Or a four-cylinder motor, right? Doesn't matter. If you put a four-cylinder with low cubic inches if you know anything about cars, in a big old semi truck, you're not going to be able to get the thing started. You're not and moving fast enough. And when you do get it going, if it hits any kind of an obstacle like a hill, or it has to stop and start over again, it's going to take a long time to get that thing going again, right? So imagine that being like air exchange whenever we're opening a door, putting cold meat on the pit. Like if your meat is 40 degrees coming out of the fridge, which is food safe, right? We shouldn't be at 100 degrees before we go in the smoker. So for food safety practices, we're going to put it on there at, you know, less than room temperature for sure. And you're going to have to bring all that meat up to whatever temperature your finished result is. Well, the entire time we're dumping heat into this meat. So we have to have a hot smoker before we can dump heat into the meat. Otherwise, the smoker has got way more surface area than your meat does. So the smoker cook chamber is absorbing more heat than the briskets are, if you think about it like that. So we have to not only move enough air through this chamber to get an even temperature, we also have to move enough air to carry the heat through the chamber and heat all of this stuff up at the same time. So the car motor would have to be a semi motor, a motor like a big diesel motor to move the truck. That's just how it works. Anyway, you could also, I guess, hypothetically have too big of a motor in a car, but the car is still going to run just fine, right? So there you go. That's kind of the way it goes. I want to move enough air to get the proper flavor, the proper texture, the proper cook time and fat render in my product so that I get the best product I can pull out. And I want all of that product to yield 100% of the cook. I don't want to sacrifice a third or a half of a brisket because my cooker doesn't cook right. So anyway, I hope that analogy helps. That's kind of what we're looking at. So like I said, just to kind of bring this all the way down, because I got my last bullet point here. We're designing the smoker in consideration of the end product we're trying to do. For instance, here's a great way to look at it. 1,000 gallon, you know, we're going to try to put a bunch of briskets on this thing. So you're likely cooking at a restaurant, or you're getting paid to cook all this brisket, or you're feeding a lot of people. We don't want to be throwing briskets away, number one. Number two, we don't want to build a bigger pit than we have to have. So we don't want to just like make 1,000 gallon if we're only going to fill it half full, right, all the time. Good to have extra capacity, but if you're doing this with that many briskets, you're probably doing this for money, which means yield is important to you. You want to make sure that if you put a 20-pound brisket on there, you're not serving 10 pounds of it. That's just kind of how what we're talking about here. And you want to make sure that every bite is the best bite throughout that brisket. Therefore, design for your end product, the amount of yield you want to have on that product, and how you want that customer or your buddy or whoever it is that's going to eat that, how you want them to feel about what your food is. Now, if you design from that backwards to like, okay, well, how big a smoker do I need? How big a firebox do I need? Just so you know, our plans on smokerplans.net take care of 100% of that math for you. So really the only thing you got to know before you buy a set of smoker plans from smokerplans.net is what you have to work with. Well, first of all, how big of a chamber do you need in as of square inches of cooking space, right? And then also, what do you have to work with? If you have a 1,000-gallon propane tank laying around, look at the dimensions on it and make sure those dimensions match a set of plans. If they do, boom, you can go to smokerplans.net and find the plans that are designed with all of this in mind. And then, you know, just one more pitch there. It comes with phone support and community support and email support. So super easy to get into our community. And I also feel like we're the most accessible company, barbecue company on the internet. I really do believe that. We have phone number is published absolutely everywhere. Someone answers the phone. If they don't answer, they do call you right back. We do have texting. You can text us on that number. Also, we have email support. There's like all of us check that email. There's chat on every platform we're on. YouTube don't have chat. It has comments, but you can get on the chat bubble on the website. Yeah, there's multiple ways to get in touch with us. And we also have our free community at smokerbuilderu.com. And you can go on there and we can have this same conversation personalized for you. There's also online courses on there as well. So anyway, my job here on earth is to help guys like you get the pit of their dreams. That's what I'm here for. So if that's you, hit us up, go check out smokerplans.net, watch more of our content, subscribe, whatever the action is on this video, I would appreciate it. And if you found the information useful, make sure to share it with other people. That's what we want. We want to help everybody. So barbecue brings people together. So anyway, I appreciate you. I appreciate your time. This recording is 29 minutes long. So if you watch the entire thing, you're a champ and I appreciate it. And let me know how I can serve you. SmokerBuilder.com, SmokerPlans.net. We'll talk soon. Thank you.